Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Today's readings are all about discipleship. From the Old Testament, we have a prophet proclaiming, "As for me and my house, we will worship the Lord." Paul, today in his letter to the church in early times, tells us that we're to put on the armor of righteousness and gives us that imagery of that's what a disciple wears. And of course, in the gospel today, Jesus is all about discipleship and what it means to follow him. And it may be surprising to us that as early as chapter 6 in John, Jesus is saying things that make people not want to follow him, that are just too big for them to get their heads around, that they're somehow going to have eternal life by eating this bread that comes down from heaven that is embodied in Jesus Christ. Being a disciple is difficult. You and I know that. Part of the difficulty of discipleship, I think, comes from the fact that it's just so easy to get into the routine of our life that we have trouble pausing and remembering to ask ourselves, what would Jesus have me do? What is Jesus calling me to do? The church has this difficulty. We get into our routines, and our routines become habit, and habits just go on and on and on. We're in that season after Pentecost, and I wonder how often we get in the habit of just being in the season after Pentecost and we don't think about it as much. Without looking at your order of service, can anybody tell me what Sunday after Pentecost we're in today? Now, I'll give you a hint. If you look in some of the prayer books, there's a little red piece of paper. Some of these red pieces of paper have the correct answer and some don't. Anybody want to throw out what their piece of paper says?
Holy Week.
19 over here. How many think it's 19? No, it's not 19. I'll tell you that. We have one over here? 12. Oh, we're getting closer. We're getting closer. You have 11. Well, now we're moving in the wrong direction. 9. Oh, we're still moving in the wrong direction.
14.
No, well, 15? Now we're in the other direction. 15.
13.
Well, 13. The 13th Sunday after Pentecost. That's where we are, I think. But you know, as disciples and as the church, aren't we really having a lot more Sundays go by than that? Mm-hmm. Was thinking about it this week, and I was talking with Christopher, and we kind of tried to figure out how many Sundays since the first Pentecost. Because really, that's how long the church has been around trying to be a disciple and follow Jesus. Now, calculating how many Sundays after the first Pentecost is complicated. You have to take the year Jesus was born, and we know it's not zero, right?
Right.
Scholars now are saying 4 BC is the best date they can do. So now we have to take Jesus' birth and add 33 years. Then we have to find the week of the first Easter. Now, finding the week of the first Easter in the year 31 is not easy to do. So you have to look at the table and make your best guess, which reconciles the Julian and the Gregorian calendars and does all those things. And then you find the first Pentecost 50 days later. Then you calculate how many years has passed between that and 2014. Then you add those in, then you work on leap years, and you do all of this stuff, and you come up with the fact that you and I and our ancestors in the church have been trying to be disciples for 100,350 years. So this would be the 103,000th 250th Sunday after Pentecost. So that's how long we're about it, and I don't know about you, but I don't know if we're getting any better or worse with it. We have to break out of our routines. We have to look beyond what has become normal and comfortable and the way we've done things always and take a fresh look at what it means to follow Jesus and be a disciple. I think that's the message of today's gospel. Talking about doing something in a new way reminded me of this clock that has been part of my life forever and ever. My parents bought this clock before I was born. And I remember the ritual on Sunday. Every Sunday my father would set it. And once a month he would open it up and take the back off and oil it. And when it broke, we'd have to pile in a little VW bug and wrap it up in a blanket and take it to the British clockmaker where it would live for a few weeks to be fixed. Then it would come back. I remember many years ago, he got some bad news from the clockmaker that the clock couldn't be fixed anymore. It had been fixed for, I don't know, 50, 60 years, and finally just wore out. And the clockmaker said, there's nothing more I can do. Well, my father took that kind of hard, as you can imagine. Then he got creative. And he went to this store called Michael's, where they have clock kits that take batteries. And he took the gears out of the back of the clock, and he glued the Michael's kit in and put the hands back on and got it all working, and now it still tells time again. It doesn't bong anymore. I kind of miss the bong. But it tells accurate time. It's an old clock with new insides and a new way of doing something. A new way of doing what it does. If you've ever been in a restroom at St. Mark's, you know we have those funny little joke cartoons that come to us from the church pension fund. Well, my favorite of them all isn't in a restroom. It's in the hallway on the way to the treasurer's office in the office building. And some of you, most of you probably have never seen that. So I brought it in today, and it's a little ocean liner, and it's a series of captions. The ocean liner is sailing along, doing very well, and all of a sudden it starts to tilt. And in the subsequent pictures, the ocean liner tilts more, and finally it sinks, and then there's nothing there but the ocean. And each of the captions goes on, it says, but we've never done it that way. Seeing discipleship with fresh eyes. Being a Christian in new and invigorating and exciting ways is something that each of us are called to do in our lives. How we do it will be as unique as the people who are gathered in this room together. Where it leads is a stunning and challenging place. It's the promise of eternal life. How we get there is eating the living bread which comes down from heaven, which is Jesus Christ. And the more nearly we follow and participate in that, the more nearly we can go about our lives as renewed disciples. And so that is my prayer for all of us, that we may each be renewed and invigorated in our ministries, and to see how we do what we do in fresh, unexpected, and inspiring ways. Amen.
Amen. Amen.